fun stuff. And I just have to do this because it's my favorite thing. I think I put it on the Sage Facebook page. I think this is the one. I have this really good estimate. You see that now I'm using a lot of the Sage typesetting things. The reason this is taking long is because I have to calculate the zeros of the Riemann zeta function from 10 to 150 in order to do this. So it's going to take a little bit of time.
By the way, there's an optional package called zeta zeros. Maybe it should be in Sage, which has the first.
Oh, like as a database or something?
Yeah, it's Adlitzka's database.
Oh, yeah, I've seen that. I just, yeah, it didn't occur to me. This is how I found them.
Well,
so.
It's optional, so it's probably good that you aren't using it, since it might not be installed at every place.
No, it's not installed on this one.
It's tiny, though. It probably should be standard.
Well, I could just use install package, wouldn't I?
Yeah, definitely.
Instead of waiting. So maybe instead I should just log into Facebook. I don't know.
Facebook? Why Facebook?
Because I posted this picture there.
Oh.
Nice. So here is the log integral function. Here is the sum of the Möbius. Those are both strictly increasing functions. And here is the so-called really good estimate. And I'm using in this picture, I think, the first. Here, this is the picture. The Riemann zeta exact formula zeros the zeta function through t equals 150 using MP math and Sage. Without MP math, I couldn't have done this. But so we need to get more stuff. But isn't this awesome? Look at this part. This is amazing. It's so close to a step function. We'll never get that with any of these strictly increasing functions.
Have you read Don Zagier's article on the first 50,000?
I know of it, but I haven't read it. No.
It's all about plotting this.
Yeah. So I mean, this thing is. I got this through a combination of a lot of things in John Derbyshire's book. Prime Obsession, which anybody who's interested in number theory should read. It's so awesome. And it took me 3 times teaching this course to finally understand exactly how the explicit formula worked. Which we have that and the book that he bases a lot of it on, which is, I forget the name, but it's this book called The Riemann Zeta Function.
Edwards' book?
The Edwards' book, right. So between Edwards' book and his book, I was able to finally understand exactly what it's doing. But to be able to show students this is possible, and it's connected to this weird zeta, and we talk about the zeta function in other contexts, because we talk about Euler products and things like that. But it's, wow. So that's Sage and number theory in interaction. And thanks to Facebook for being online and letting us post cool pictures. I encourage if you make cool graphics with Sage, we have a nice place to put them on Facebook so that people will do them. If you aren't a friend of Sage on Facebook, you should like Sage on Facebook. Sadly, then don't be on Facebook. I totally support anyone who does not want to be on Facebook.
Can you know you are?
No, you should join Facebook. And
that is the scalable answer.
That's right, scalable, exactly. By the way, there's a lot of math places do update with nice pictures. The AMS has some really good updates. Sadly, and this is to one of the people in the audience, the MAA does not seem to have. Is nice of updates on Facebook, but it's a nice way to keep your message in front of people. So anyway, Sage and math and number theory. Thank you.
All right.
Questions, Tom?
Yeah.
So,
Tom.
You did a lot more programming than I did, and I purposely avoided programming,
yes.
And I'll explain why.
That's why I said early on,
yeah.
Tailor it to you,
yeah.
and your students. So that your students part is how much programming you make them see. The you is how much programming you want or can't,
yeah.
do. These started small, okay? This was not in the original version of my class.
Yeah.
What
happens is our students take a programming course in Java, and it's it's computer science is in the business school. We don't think it really does the job, but we haven't been able to change it. So on Rob's advice, I did not use the word programming or Python when I told them about Sage.
Right.
I just told them Sage will make your life easier. My goal is to have them come to my office and beg me to use a for loop.
Right.
So,
that's a totally appropriate pedagogical thing to do.
Yeah.
But the reason that I did this is because I had sort of the opposite goal. Well, I didn't want them to ever have to ask me to do it for them. I wanted to make everything so easy that even somebody who would have been scared to ask about a for loop would still be able to move the sliders and the drop downs, which is why the interact
yeah.
is so awesome. But it really depends on what your goals are and what you want to do. And so, you know, and one of the things is I teach number theory with my main pedagogical goal, not being sage. My main goal is showing the unity of mathematics. And that means there's stuff that we do have to, we can't spend hours and hours on a million different proofs of, you know, some big thing. We can't do as much inquiry-based stuff as I'd like. We do a little bit. And it also means that we move fairly, we don't go in depth in any one particular subject. Because I want to make sure that they see this on the last day of class, which I finally achieved this time. It took three tries to get right. But if your goal is to go a little slower and go more in depth and do some inquiry-based stuff, or notebooks like you're saying, right? That's a great, I've used that in my transition to proof class, little notebook things, graph theory. Yeah, then it's very appropriate to keep the programming to a minimum and have them get frustrated with how they have to keep on typing A equals 5, not going to type A equals 10.
And a way around the Facebook account is if you post these things to Facebook, you can actually automatically post them to Twitter, okay, and get the images there. And if you sign up for a Twitter account, you don't have, you can just follow accounts and you, or follow people, and you don't have
right.
to
right.
give them all the garbage
okay.
about yourself.
Yeah,
so
right.
that would be a way around it.
Sure. Yeah.
I'll add to what Tom said.
Yeah.
You can get really far with list comprehensions.
Yes, yes.
So it is worth trying to, when you want to write a for loop, see if you can't write a list comprehension.
Yes.
And then some functions like sum and prod, it'll do sums and products on a list. And then there's an all and an any.
Yep.
You know, so if you want a list of trues or false, you want to see if something doesn't happen or does happen or always happens. So if you get creative and put a little bit of investment into thinking how to do that yourself, and your students will pick that up from a worksheet or whatever, I think, happened pretty quickly. And so in what I do, what I prepared for Tom's course is that I would use over a year, I think I can make it to March without a for loop.
Right. William? Just rushing.
Mm-hmm.
Karen?
So I wanted to clarify the sort of process a little bit, maybe you said just at the beginning. So you have all these worksheets, one for each lecture, and you present the, so you sort of go up to the front of the room and have this worksheet
and
so
we go through it. Now that's not an ideal workflow. The workflow started as here's a book, you read pieces of it and I enhance it in class with Sage. Went to here's the Sage worksheets and you use the book to read a few things ahead of time. To here's the worksheets but I'm trying to get them in perfect form so that at the end of the semester I have a book and so you can't read them ahead of time. But the ideal workflow is next time read the worksheet ahead of time with the book, and then we go through some of it in class and delve more deeply into the proofs. I was lucky this semester I had very talented students, so it didn't really impact them in that way. And if I wouldn't have, I probably would have used the worksheets from before and said, read these. I would have done a different workflow.
So then how much do you have the students themselves using Sage? Are they just looking at your notebooks
in the homework? In the homework, they sometimes they don't have to use it at all. They just see the picture, like if we're in class trying to guess a theorem. And then they prove it without Sage, presumably. I guess. Maybe they can use Sage to prove it. And then other times I say, like, you know, go use Sage to calculate something about primitive root of this and then use it to do the LDMAL or whatever. And then they have to use Sage.
And
you know,
you're just running a server that they can.
Yeah, so this is our this is our local server.
I had a question about that, actually.
Yeah.
So you've got a local server at your university.
Right.
How does that work with students getting in campuses, like, does it
so
integrate with Moodle at all?
These are questions that I know that people talk about a lot, but I don't want to answer them because it would take a lot of extra time, and
okay.
I'm not the one to answer them. But these are things we've been talking about all week, actually, with some of the folks, and the Education Day folks in particular.
As of right now, it doesn't integrate.
Yeah, there are answers to all your questions, and there you should ask Jason and Dan Drake and Rado. Yeah, all people who set up things like that. Yeah, there's answers on every page of that. I just don't have them. Or at least I don't have good versions of them. Yeah, thanks.
All right, take a break before our next talk.
So time went short and I went long. Sorry.
Okay.
Time went short and I went long.